Have you ever wanted to control something with your mind? To change the channels on a TV, dim the lights, or send text messages just by thinking about it? The technology that could enable this possibility is called brain-computer interfaces, and it will one day redefine how we communicate to computers and with each other. Hi, I'm Harrison Canning, and in this video, we are going to talk about many of the ways brain-computer interfaces are currently being used and dream a little about where these technologies might take us. Brain-computer interfaces, shortened to BCIs, use brain or nervous system data to control computers or machines. Examples of this could be controlling a video game character, manipulating prosthetics, or driving a vehicle just by thinking. Let's start with a category called motor neuroprosthetics. We are using this term to describe brain-computer interfaces that generate physical movement. This includes prosthetic limbs, exosuits, and vehicle control. Neuroprosthetic limbs add advanced brain control to robotic limbs. This clip shows Kathy Hutchinson, who has tetraplegia, using her mind to reach out with a robotic arm and grab a sip of coffee. This is the first time in nearly 15 years that she was able to do this without help from a caretaker. This is an example of a neuroprosthetic that taps directly into the brain. It consisted of one 96-pin microelectrode grid implanted into her motor cortex called the BrainGate 2. The device used population encoding to determine the direction Kathy wanted to move the arm. A few years later, in 2016, DARPA's Revolutionizing Prosthetics program, which has over $100 million of investment, reported that their modular prosthetic limb project was able to add an accurate sensation of touch to brain-controlled prosthetic limbs. Their research also made use of the BrainGate 2, this time placing one electrode grid in the motor cortex to allow for control, and one over the somatosensory cortex to provide tactile sensation. Nathan Copland, a volunteer for the study, is shown being able to correctly identify which of the robot's five fingers are being touched with 95% accuracy while blindfolded. Can you imagine what must have been going through Nathan's mind when he was able to feel through a robotic arm? Another group of researchers in this program showed how the same arm can be controlled accurately, this time using non-invasive electromyographic signals, or EMG, from the peripheral nervous system. The objective is the same, to use nerve signals either in the brain or body to control prosthetics as intuitively as you would your own arm. This type of approach is more common for amputees as it does not require brain surgery. This system uses two EMG armbands to control a robotic arm. After hours of training, users are able to exert an impressive amount of control over the arm. With surgery, nerves in the upper arm can be moved around to make the arm more accurate and even stimulate a sense of touch, similar to the brain-controlled arm. If you're on a budget, there are tons of 3D printed prosthetics out there on the market. Many of them use EMG as a simple on or off switch to control more basic prosthetic functions, such as gripping an object. Building an EMG prosthetic is a great project to get into when you're first learning about BCIs. Okay, so we have seen how a limb can be controlled using the power of thought and some fancy computer algorithms. But what if we wanted to control an entire exosuit? Exosuits, as it turns out, have their applications outside of just eccentric billionaires looking to fight crime. The military is actively making investments in exosuits to allow their soldiers to run faster while carrying more equipment over longer distances. For civilians with neuromuscular disorders or paralysis, exosuits may allow them to walk and interact with the world in a more human way. Building a control system for an exosuit has always been the biggest limiting factor, especially for people in locked-in states that have limited motor control over their bodies. Since the brain is already sending signals to your muscles, why not tap into these signals to control an assistive robotic suit? Brain-computer interfaces that can tap into all areas of the motor cortex would offer a theoretical one-to-one control over these systems. This would be way more accurate than any other control method. But as it turns out, you don't even need to tap into the motor cortex in its entirety to gain control over your robotic suit. Over the years, the Walk Again Project has released numerous videos demonstrating how EEG-controlled exosuits can help people, well, walk again. The system is entirely non-invasive and uses motor imagery patterns as triggers to move the robot's legs. In 2014, during the Olympics in Brazil, a paralyzed user kicked out the game ball for the opening soccer match using one of these systems. The user only had to imagine themselves moving using motor imagery to make the robot kick. In recent years, it has been found that using the suit has been therapeutic and users started to regain small amounts of previously lost motor function. There are also dozens of examples of mind-controlled wheelchairs that provide basic control using either motor imagery, P300 signals, or population encoding to drive the system. There are many projects floating around the internet showing how EEG or EMG can be used to control toy drones, robots, or smart devices. Like the prosthetics, this is a great first project to tackle if you're looking to get your feet wet with neurotech. As we continue to advance BCI technology, we will have increased ability to receive commands from the motor cortex. If we were able to have a one-to-one control scheme, you could theoretically have the most accurate control system possible. Could you imagine driving a car just by thinking, with no need for the steering wheel? This possibility isn't just for physical vehicles and machines, it could also work with virtual interfaces as well. The ways that we interact with computers are currently fairly limited. For most of us, we receive all of our information through a two-dimensional screen and enter information through a keyboard and mouse. Interfacing directly with the brain would be the ultimate way to interact with the technology. It could redefine how we think about data and encourage machines and computers to work in a more human way. We saw in the last section how the motor cortex can be used to move objects through physical space, but could this apply to virtual spaces as well? Could we combine sensory areas to create a more intimate experience with the data where we can sense information and see it overlaid in our visual field? Could we replace the need for monitors, speakers, a keyboard, and mouse by streaming all of that information into the brain through a bi-directional brain-computer interface? That is the dream for many neurotechnologists. Let's take a look at where we are today. Research published in 2018 showed three participants successfully engaging with an Android tablet to use several common applications, including typing, searching the web, sending emails, searching for and watching YouTube videos, and checking the weather. Participants each had two of the BrainGate systems implanted over their motor cortices. They would imagine moving their hand around in 3D space for movement and squeezing their hand for selection. The computer would then convert motor imagery data from this imagined movement into mouse coordinates that were transmitted to the tablet via Bluetooth. As you can see, they were really successful with these devices. Want to use your brain to type without getting an implant? The P300 speller is a very common technique for achieving text input using non-invasive EEG or through the semi-invasive ECOG interfaces. While using the system, you would see a matrix of flashing letters. To type, you would focus your gaze onto your target letter. It is fairly simple to set up, and there are hundreds of studies that you can find using this method that make modifications to the electrodes, the algorithm, or the keyboard layout to achieve different results. Most papers report accuracy between 60 and 90%, with average selection times ranging from 4 to 12 seconds. As the tech advances, we will be able to drastically change the ways we think about computer interfaces. What if, instead of looking at a 2D screen, you could enter into an interface and have files presented to you as if they were physical objects? This would change the ways we work, but it would change the ways we play as well. Can we take the interfaces that we discussed in the last two sections to the next level by controlling and in some ways sensing the experience of characters within a video game? BCIs are already showing their capabilities in the entertainment realm, especially with video games. With full motor and sensory control, it's possible that we could have a future where you can actually enter into a video game, where you could feel and sense what the character is feeling. Through this, we could give humans sensorial experiences that transcend the human body and current existence. Many classic video games have already been adapted to a simple BCI control scheme. You can play Pac-Man, Tetris, and pinball using EEG just by imagining the target object moving in the desired direction. Now, Harrison, you might say, these games are all pretty simple. When will I be able to play games like Minecraft and feel like I'm in the game actually punching trees? Well, I hear you, and luckily the neurotechnologist Miguel Nicolelis does too. In 2013, his team demonstrated that some of his lab monkeys could use an invasive BCI to control the arms of a virtual avatar to touch virtual objects. The system sampled data from 500 electrodes and used population encoding to determine direction. The team later built on this system to add the sensation of touch in virtual worlds. Now, instead of moving targets, the monkey would feel both targets, looking for a specific tactile sensation. When it felt the target sensation, it would select that object. The company Control Labs, which was acquired by Facebook in 2018, produced a prototype of a wristband that could very accurately map finger actuation and hand positioning by monitoring electromyographic signals and accelerometer data. The ability to have very accurate hand control in virtual worlds without surgery obviously has very exciting implications. This shows one example where neurotechnology can integrate well with augmented and virtual reality. Instead of the clunky controllers we currently use, we might be able to just use our hands in the very near future. In 2017, the BCI company Neurable debuted an EEG device that fit into the back of the HTC Vive headset. They also created an entirely mind-controlled virtual reality game called The Awakening to go along with it. Some companies, like Valve, are investigating how EEG and other biodata can be used to measure engagement while playing video games. They have experimented with using emotional responses and attention to change the game world. This could be used in the future to create more immersive gaming experiences. So far, we have talked about controlling objects, whether physical or virtual, and maybe even getting sensory feedback from them. But what about speech and communication? Well, at the risk of sounding like Apple's "There's an app for that" campaign, there are BCIs for that too. Language is the oldest and most important human invention. But compared to the speed in which computers communicate, it's pretty clunky and slow. Think about it. If I want to tell you a story, I would first have to imagine the experience in my mind and try to take what I heard, saw, smelled, and felt and package it into words that your brain would then try to reconstruct to connect with the story. Like a game of telephone, a lot of data is lost based on your perception of what was said based on your own experiences. But what if instead of telling you about my experience, I could just send you that memory? What if we had direct brain-to-brain interfaces? In 2013, Nikolelis and a team of researchers successfully developed the first brain-to-brain interface, or BTBI, which allowed two lab rodents to share sensory motor information and work together for a reward. The first rat's cage would have a flashing light, the visual stimulus, and that would change colors between trials, and the decoder rat's cage contained several colored levers. The visual centers of the rat's brains were connected through the interface so that the color the first rat saw would be transmitted to the second. Together, they performed significantly above average with 65% accuracy. This research was furthered in his 2015 BrainNet project, where the brains of three primates were connected. The primates were all able to move an arm over a target in digital 3D space. One monkey was able to control the forward and back motion of the arm, one left and right, and one up and down. The monkeys were able to work together with their brainwaves to move the arm over a target. Yikes, as cool as that is, it is a little scary. Not to worry though, there are some non-invasive neurofeedback devices that can calm your nerves. There are several BCI applications which focus on total levels of brain activity and frequency bands to indicate wakefulness. These devices have been used for meditation, focus, and sleep enhancement. These are all forms of neurofeedback technology. Neurofeedback changes cues of a system based on the indicators from the brain, such as wakefulness. For example, the Muse headset, which is designed for meditation, plays louder music when it notices you may have been distracted, and softer music with birds chirping when it notices your brainwaves synchronizing, which indicates focus and relaxation. Similar applications are available for sleep and focus. Could we use a BCI to measure whether someone is lying? You may have seen the polygraph test, used on TV by police officers, as a lie detector. The polygraph measures a subject's bodily reactions, such as skin conductivity, blood pressure, and heart rate changes. It is generally considered to be unreliable as a lie detector by most scientists because it detects anxiety rather than truthfulness. Farwell and Donchin, in 1991, developed a P300 event-related BCI for lie detection. The goal was to see if P300 signals were elicited when remembering a situation. Recall that P300 signals are unconsciously generated. For 88% of participants, the system worked with 100% accuracy in detecting a lie. Abnormal brainwaves can be picked up by EEG devices to diagnose brain issues like concussion and Alzheimer's. EEG is also used for ongoing seizure monitoring. Outlets for creativity are very important for people who are in locked-in states. Because of this, a team of researchers developed a way for disabled artists to create art. Using a brain-computer interface, patients were able to select simple painting tools such as colors, shapes, and paintbrushes, and move them to a digital canvas to create shapes. This device has been used by a number of ALS patients and even one non-disabled artist. Providing these outlets for creativity is crucial for mental health, and this tool may help many thousands of people in the future. Cosplayers and technologists alike have found ways to use EMG and EEG to control motors and lights on clothing. There's clothing that displays heartbeat, shows mood, or uses these technologies as a switch to effortlessly control on-person indicators. One particularly cool example of this is the G-Tech Pangolin Scales project, which debuted at the 2020 Ars Electronica Festival. It featured 1,024 EEG channels that used brain activity to control lights and motors on the dress. In this video, we covered many of the applications of BCIs. We learned that they can be used to control prosthetics, vehicles, and computers, that one day they could create immersive gaming experiences, are used to enhance sleep, focus, and meditation, diagnose illnesses, and enhance the ways we create and consume art. In this next lesson, we will dive into the ethics and philosophy of brain-computer interfaces.